Hey there, YouTube. This is a tutorial video. I'm going to be doing a lot of detailed steps, and it's going to be about 12 or 15 minutes long. If you're not interested in the subject matter, go ahead and skip this video, and that's cool. I've got a few friends of mine that are in the process of trying to configure a CNC machine, and so what I'm doing is I'm going step by step through the process to kind of explain to them what all the stuff does. So like I said, if you're into it, yay. If not, you might find this one a little bit boring. But anyway, if you are following along and you're looking for more details on the CNC or you want to see what my progress is, you can always go here to askjerry.info and then click on the CNC tab. There's a bunch of good information on there and you can follow along on my progress. Anyway, let's get started. I've got this LinuxCNC box set up. It's got the latest version of Debian Wheezy on it. I'm shooting off the screen because I don't have a screen capture program, so I'm doing the best I can do. Anyway, what we want to do is we want to end up with a engraver CNC machine. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to do that from scratch. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to erase what I've already got on here. Okay, and I'm going to go in here and do the same thing. So now that's erased. So you're starting off with a blank machine. This is what you would do. The first thing we want to do is we want to come in to CNC and go to Step Configuration Wizard. Now it's going to ask you whether you want to create a new configuration or modify something that's already been started. So we're going to say we want to start something new and hit forward. It comes up with a name and it always defaults to My Mill. So we're going to be doing an engraving machine. So I call it engraver and that's going to set my file path. Then I can tell it what type of a machine I want. In this case, it's just an X, Y, and Z. Then, depending on your part of the world, inches or millimeters for your default. And then you've got a bunch of settings for speed and pulse width and all this kind of stuff. And I'll tell you, 99 times out of 100, if you just set it for Gecko 540, all this stuff is going to work just fine. If it doesn't, you can go back and tweak it later. The next step is this is what's called a base period minimum jitter. Basically, this number tells it how fast the machine is and what it's capable of doing. So it defaults at some 43,000 instructions per second that it can handle. And I know this is an older machine and that's not going to fly. So I can hit this and it comes up and it starts doing an evaluation. And then you're supposed to open files up and so forth. Basically, I've tested this machine several times, and I know it runs at about 25,000, which when I put that in as a number, it's going to set this to about 30,000 hertz or whatever. And that's good because a Gecko drive can only run about 25 or so, so it's fine. Come in here, and now this is important. This is very important. This is where you set your pins for the particular bore that you're going to do. So we want to set that up and we want to be fairly accurate with it. Okay, now I'm going to be using this. This is the Stain Smart breakout board, and because I'm using this, I've got some predefined pins, and I'll zoom in on that now so you can take a look at it. Okay, so you can see that it's got all of the pins defined on here as far as what connects to what. So what we're going to do is we're going to match that. So the first thing we've got is an e-stop output. That means if the machine has a problem and it crashes or stops for whatever emergency reason, it's going to output a signal here. That signal gets fed through all the enable pins and it basically tells stuff, hey, stop, don't do anything else, etc. The next ones, X, Y, and Z, the step and direction pins, are already preset for the Stain Smart board, which is very convenient. If we were doing a fourth axis, we would use these as well, but we're not. So right now, we can set them to unused. We'll continue on down. This is the spindle clockwise. Now, if your machine had a spindle with a forward and a reverse, you could set one of these other pins as an output for the reverse, but we're going to leave it as spindle clockwise for right now. There's a spindle pulse width modulation. Now, if you have a VFD, a speed control for your spindle, it could be connected here. I do not, so I'm going to set this as unused. And then down here is an amplifier enable. Again, I'm not going to use that. I don't have an amplifier enable on my spindle. But what I do have is I have mist cooling. So I'm going to set this up for my coolant mist so that when I'm running, I can cool my part off so it doesn't overheat. Now here, these are inputs from the mill or whatever device to your PC. So if you're going to be using automatic homing switches, for example, I like to set the X, Y, and Z here. Or you could tie them all together and it'll go through a sequence. But for right now, because I just want to show you manual zeroing, we're going to leave those as unused. That leaves the remaining two. We'll start with the bottom one. I like to put a probe in there. You might not think you're going to use a probe, but they're really handy, and I recommend putting it in there. If you don't use it, it's pre-configured. You've got it. You don't have to go back and reconfigure it later. The other one to put in is an e-stop input. This way you can make yourself a big old red button. If there's a problem, you can mash it and stop the machine. If you have a light curtain or, you know, if one of your drivers fails and it has a fail signal, you could put it in there. The other thing that I like to do is on the spindle, I like to hit invert. And the reason I do that is because the Stain Smart board, it's got this relay right here. And when you first power this board up and run the LinuxCNC, this relay is going to change states. It's going to go to a light on. And if that happens and you've got something hooked onto this machine, it could start up. Somebody could get hurt. So I like to leave it inverted so when the program starts up, it starts up in the off position. So it doesn't change states until such time as you actually click the button. And then you can wire these inputs accordingly. So once we've done that, we move forward, and it's going to ask you if you want to have a custom panel or not. Now, even if you think you don't want one, go ahead and tell it to include one and include a blank panel. If it's not used, it's going to appear as a little tiny 2 or 3 millimeter, 1/8 inch wide strip on the side. You won't even notice it, but if you ever want to add one, it's there, and it's real easy to do at that time. Hit forward. And now you go into this part of the setup. In this part of the setup, you're basically telling it, if you've got a stepper, how many steps per revolution that you've got, or if you've got a Gecko drive and it's hooked up to a servo with an optical encoder, you're going to basically be telling it how many revolutions. Microstepping is 1 for none, 2 if you do have microstepping. And then this lead pulley, let's say you've got a stepper motor, but it doesn't have a lot of power to it. You could do a 2-to-1 or a 3-to-1 ratio, which is going to give you more steps, and it's also going to boost up your power. This would need to know that. And then if you're using a threaded rod, you would put that in here. If it's a direct drive, you would set it to 1. You set these up, and then it should have an idea of how to maneuver your machine. So then you click on Test This Axis. You'll go in here and you can actually move it back and forth. So say you start doing that and you notice that the servos or the steppers are making a horrendous sound, they're missing steps. You can change your acceleration, you can change your maximum velocity to fix that. Once you get that set up, you can come in here and hit, let's say, plus, and then set it for 1 inch if you're in the States, or 10 millimeters or 20 millimeters if you're overseas, and hit run. And now your machine's going to be going back and forth, and you can look at it. If you're expecting it to move an inch and it's, you know, way beyond that, you know something's wrong with your math. You can then go back in here and experiment with other settings. And then once you get it to where it's pretty close or it looks like it's correct, you can move on to your next axis. Down in here, you've got a home position and you've got table travel. Now, I've got a machine and it's got a very long run. It'll go 30 inches. So I'm going to set this for 30 inches. And then for this particular axis, my home location is 0, which is all the way over, so that's fine. We're going to continue forward, go to the y-axis. Same thing, my y-axis is 12 inches. We've got our y-axis set up, and we go through, and we go to our z-axis. Same thing. Now, you notice on the z-axis, it starts at a negative number because it's going to be moving predominantly downward. The positive number is when it retracts upward. On my particular machine, because of the way I've got my home switch located, I want an extra inch because I'm going to set a routine where I hit go home and it's going to go up an inch and then go over. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set this for -3 and I'm going to set the vertical to 1. And you may have to experiment with your machine. Anyway, you get that done. Hit forward. It's going to tell you to check over a few things and tell it quit. Now you'll notice I've got an engraver folder and I've got an engraver launcher. This folder contains all of the special files that are needed to make that virtual machine run, and then this will actually launch the machine. So we click on it and the panel comes up. And if you notice, there's a little gap over here. That's our custom panel down the side, and we can add stuff to it later should we desire to do it. Because we set an external switch, you'll notice that I don't have to click on this. It's already set. So all I need to do is hit power. The devices all become live. I can home the axes. And then if I want to, I can come down here, and you see the jog speed is set fairly slowly. I can hit the button. And you see this is barely moving. I can speed it up. And you can see that I can control the direction of the machine. Okay? So that's basically what you need to do to set up the machine. After that, it's some fine-tuning. And I'll cover that in more detail in future videos. So, thanks for watching.